Good morning. Hey, you sound like you're awake. That's awesome. Welcome to Fayette Baptist Church. Welcome to Sunday, time of corporate worship. My prayer for you is that you walk in worship all the time. In Thessalonians, it says, in everything, give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And if he was going to talk about that verse, he'd probably talk about giving thanks. But the deepness, the deeper thought in that is this. Giving thanks is worship, isn't it? And it says in everything, not for everything. Because, you know, life has its ups and downs. It has its contrast. It's bad and it's good. Further down in that same chapter, it says, hold fast to that which is good and abstain from every form of evil. When you do that, you're worshiping. And I think of all the contrasts, all the things through the scripture. We think of Moses and his life, his ups and downs, Joseph, Abraham, Jacob. Think of Paul. We think of Jesus, ultimately, right? Hold fast to what is good. So we all carry a lot of junk around. Each and every week, something happens or whatever. We're told to hold fast to what is good. And the ultimate victory, obviously, is in Jesus Christ, isn't it? At the cross. But it all centers around who we're going to worship in all those different contrasts and circumstances in our lives. Amen is right. That's where our focus should be, even on this day. So come now, let's stand, let's worship our God and Father in Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. And we have a new song this morning, so let's just go through the chorus a couple, maybe once or twice, just to kind of get an idea of what it, how it goes. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. I don't know what you're doing, but I know what you've done, and I'm fighting a battle you've already won. All right, let's do that one more time, just to make sure we've got it. Sounds good. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. I don't know what you're doing, but I know what you've done, and I'm fighting a battle.
Tomorrow's in your hands. All I
My
Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Thank you.
sent his son.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, We pray that the Wiles family, the Farish-Eaton family, the Davis family and others might know deep in their hearts that we can face tomorrow, not on our own strength, but because you live. May they hold on to that hope. And Father, we do need you. We need you every hour, every minute, every moment. We need you. We need you working in our lives. In the lives of Lynn Smith's mother, John Baudet, the Coffin's son-in-law, Aaron, and many, many others. We need you. Not just physical healing, not just emotional healing, but healing of our very spirits, our souls. We need you, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would just work in and through us. Help us, Lord, to be an encouragement to others, especially those who are grieving right now. Especially those who are watching loved ones go through so much pain, so much hurt. Healing of families, healing of relationships. And primarily, may that relationship between us and you, you and us, may there be healing for that as well. Help us, Lord, to keep our eyes fixed on you. For you are indeed our hope. We cannot face tomorrow without you. Help us, Lord, to lean on you, that you would carry us through. We are thankful, Lord, for this day. So very thankful that we can gather here together to worship you, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and to be an encouragement to one another. Your word tells us that the world is watching us, and they will know that we are your disciples by our love and our care for one another. Pray, Lord, that they would see that. Pray for Pastor Chris as he brings the message this morning. Would you please speak through him to each one of us? Give us open ears and open hearts, willing to apply what the Holy Spirit is speaking through him. Thank you so much, Lord, for our Sunday school teachers and the helpers. Pray, Lord, that the children would also listen and to receive as well. For all the many needs amongst us, Lord, give us sensitive ears to hear and to respond as we can. We only pray this because Jesus made it possible by his death on the cross and his resurrection 3 days later. So it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Please have a seat. Just a couple of quick announcements. Just a reminder that in the past couple of years, we've done a different time for July and August. We're not doing that this year, okay? Just for your information. Normal time for July and August. Also, there are a lot of prayer needs that are going on in and through the church, through the body, through people we know and love. And we encourage you to be a part of the so-called prayer chain, which is on email, so you can contact the office to be placed if you're not currently there. And the only other announcement today is that right after the service today, we will have our annual church business meeting. And if you call this your home church, we absolutely encourage you to stay to hear and learn and listen to all the great things that are happening throughout the church here, all the different projects and activities and missions. And maybe something, you'll hear something that triggers your response and say, you know what, I can be a part of that. So we encourage you to stay if you call this your home church. And with that, I would ask Pastor Henry. He would like to have a word.
Or two. Thanks, Charlie. Well, every month we feature missionaries. Missionary of the month, we call it. And so today are the Reeds. So Allison and Doug Reed with Haitian Ministries. And they didn't come from Haiti, but almost. They drove all the way up from Florida, Bangor, and then you hear this. Friday you came up from Florida? That's crazy. So thank you so much for being here with us this morning. I love, as you see at the very bottom of the screen there, helping Haitians help Haitians for God's glory. So generally when we support missionaries, it's because they're serving full time in a location, be that here in the United States or overseas. And again, Allison and Doug aren't able to do that, but it's wonderful the team they have on the ground there in Haiti and the work that they're doing. So looking forward to hearing about that this morning. So please come up and share with us.
Good morning. I just really enjoy worshiping with your church. It's been almost a year since we've been here last, but there's such a sweet spirit, and I'm not just saying it. We go to many churches, and it's just a beautiful place to be and to worship corporately together. So thank you for having us today. I wanted to update you on what we've been doing for Haitian Ministries. And basically, if you've heard any of the news, Haiti is in a really hard place right now. It's extremely dangerous with the gangs, and they ousted their president. He tried to get back into the country, and they attacked the airports, and he wasn't able to get back into the country. And so right now, the United States has appointed an interim again, which honestly, the Haitians don't really like that. They want to have their own voice, and they want to have their own vote. And so basically, this is supposed to be a 2-year plan, and they formed a committee, and the hope and the idea is that they would be able to hold an election in about 2 years. So we'll see. In January, I took a team, myself and my daughter, and Pam Brochu, who you guys know, and a nurse practitioner went with us into Haiti, and we were able to do some amazing work in our communities with medical, but also just evangelistic as well, and bringing encouragement to them. It's a great encouragement to our Haitian team when we're able to go there to be with them, because we will hold team building exercises for them, and we hold devotions obviously for them, and just really encourage them and build them up in the work that they're doing, because they're living a very hard life day in and day out. And it's just your support of Haitian ministries is what really funds their whole ministry. Doug and I don't take any of that. We just kind of facilitate it. I get to Western Union and get them the money that they need to fix our truck, right? Or, and when we go on a trip like we did in January, the team is responsible to raise all their own money. My daughter and I raise our own money and take care of our own expenses, so that any money that is given to Haitian ministries can directly go to Haitian ministries and the Haitians that are doing the work. So we were in Haiti in January, and we're having a great week and doing a lot of amazing things, seeing the Lord just show up day in and day out. Like, it was like you would just pray, like, Lord, show us where you want us today. And then we walk out the gate, and there's this lady that just needed to see us. And even the house right next door to the pastor where we were staying, it was actually terrifying at first, because I was up on the roof, and there was a mom out there, and you guys won't be able to kind of relate to this, but there's no fence or anything on the roof. It's just like a concrete slab. And the mom was just kind of laying in the sun, and her little baby, who probably wasn't even two yet, I would say she's probably like 15, 16 months, is just walking around on that roof. And I'm just like standing there, my American mom, you know, and I'm just like, oh my word, what am I going to do if she gets too close to the edge? And but the Lord used that moment. He just like really said, you need to go visit that mom. And so I let the pastor know. I said, you know, we got to go visit that mom tomorrow. And he said, okay, I'll go over and let her know that you're going to come. And so we went over, and it was crazy. Her husband wasn't home. He actually works for Compassion International. And so when he has to go work, he has to go away for like a week at a time. So it was just her and her baby. And I had our nurse practitioner take her blood pressure. And it was through the roof, you guys. It was like 225 over, like, I can't even remember the, I wish I had my notes in front of me, but the nurse was just like, oh my word, like, she needs to see a doctor. She needs to go in the hospital. And high blood pressure is a thing that we find in Haiti a lot. So that's one of our main things, is to kind of get them on a blood pressure program when we find this. But what we had learned from this mom is that she already had had preeclampsia. She'd already had a stroke, so she had lost like the use of one side of her leg. She had a limp in her arm. And we were able to just really educate her that the major importance of just taking her medication, just being educated of, you're not going to make it for this little baby if you don't start taking your medicine. So we were able, through a translator, to ask her, do you have medicine? And she had medicine in her bedroom, just sitting there, because she was thinking, I need to save it for when I really, really need it. And we told her, we're like, the time is now, you really, really need it. And so we went back the whole time we were there, every single day, to kind of get her in a habit of taking the medicine. The first day she only had taken one pill. She had two prescriptions because her blood pressure was so high. So then we told her, did you take both? No. And it was just like, really, the Lord just, he must have something special for her. But he just was like, it was like we had to just train her and teach her, like, you need to take this medicine, like, it's not going to do you any good. And she's just one example of someone that the Lord just was like, this person needs to see our team and see our people. Unfortunately, soon after that week, we had another week to go, and the country started to get really unstable. And we had to be kind of shut into a little community. They did let us go out on the streets in this community, but we couldn't go out on the roads because there was rioting and roadblocks. Just to give you guys an idea, there's no means to get money in Haiti. And so one way that the people will get money is the gangs will come from Port-au-Prince down to like the city where we were in Cap and offer to pay people if they cause a riot, if they do a roadblock. And so the people are so desperate to feed their families and to survive for that day. A lot of them, really without malice in their heart, will take the job and do it. And it just creates this chaos. And that's what was happening. So I was able to get Pam and Lisa, I was able to get them on a plane with MFI and fly them out. So that left my daughter and I in Haiti. There was no room for us on the plane. So we were like, okay, well, the Lord already knew. He has a plan. And so we went to church with the Haitians that Sunday, and we began our work. And then I would say probably come Tuesday, it was February 7th, where there was a huge uprising, and it was just completely unsafe to be in Haiti, whether you're Haitian, American, whatever. It was just unsafe territory. I've never been in that situation before, and I had my 24-year-old daughter with me, so I just really committed it to the Lord and said, you knew we were going to be here, and you have a plan. The hard part is there's no electricity, so we were there, right, with, like, no phones, no electricity. You're just, like, looking at concrete walls and praying a lot, reading the Bible a lot and all the books we brought. But we contacted MFI, who's the people that we fly with, and they said, we're sorry, we're not coming into Haiti to get you on Tuesday. So I was like, okay, it's okay. God has a plan. And Wednesday came, and we were going to take a little walk to somewhere where I knew they had Wi-Fi, and I wanted to contact my husband, you know. And on the way on that walk, I saw a trampled snake on the ground, and I tell you, I've never seen a snake in Haiti. They really honestly don't have a lot of crazy wildlife. It's just a lot of dogs and things like that. But when I saw that snake trampled, like he was flat, it was like the Lord said, I am going to do it. Just trust me. I will get you out of here. So I said, okay. And let Doug know that hopefully Thursday would be the day. And Thursday came, and Thursday was not the day. And so we were just, I would be lying if I didn't say we were super disappointed, because we wanted to get back to our family in the States, and we couldn't really do anything with our team. I almost felt like a burden a little bit for the team, because they had these two Americans with them, you know, and I didn't want to bring any attention to them. So we were able to just pretty much beg MFI if they had any opportunity to get us out on Friday. They don't usually fly. They only fly on Tuesdays and Thursdays. If they would maybe make an effort, because the gangs, it's really, they create all this chaos, and then on the weekend, they stop the chaos to allow the Haitians and townspeople to go into town and get their goods that they're going to need for the week ahead. And then it will all start over again on Monday. So MFI sent us word that if we could get to the airport, then they would fly their plane in to get us. And so we talked with the Haitians, and at 6:30 a.m. that morning, Doug had a team praying over here in the States, and we were praying, and we were told by the Haitians we could have no skin showing. So my daughter and I didn't even really take long sleeves to Haiti. As you can imagine, it's pretty hot. I wore like leggings on my arms, and we covered our faces and wore sunglasses, and the Lord took us through 10 roadblocks without any problem. We had to go up on the sidewalks to get around them. When we get to this road that's not traveled a lot, the motorcycle my daughter and I are riding on, I say motorcycle loosely, it's kind of like a dirt bike with the driver and my daughter in the middle and me hanging on for dear life in the back. The front tire popped in the middle of a mud puddle, great crater. And, you know, my daughter and I, we were ready to walk. We're like, it's okay, we'll just walk. And right then, another motorcycle driver came around the corner. I mean, it was 6:30 in the morning. So, and he was the nicest man, and I'm just super thankful for the way the Lord provided for us. And we got to the airport, and we're muddy and dirtied, but we were able to get home later that night, and that's how God definitely just showed up on that trip. He showed up for the Haitians in many ways, and he showed up for us personally. So we were hoping to go back in June, and as you can see, I'm here and not there. So I'm raising some money for them to be able to have their own VBS and do a soccer evangelistic clinic, because that's what our team would have done for them. And so that's something that we're currently raising money for. And then the other thing is something that's hugely important to our ministry is our truck. And it's, we do everything out of it. The team uses it, and it's where we are when we're in Haiti all the time, and it's starting to show its wear and tear. So we're beginning to create a fund for when we need the new truck to be able to purchase it. So that's our current fundraising efforts, and that's our update. Pam did amazing in Haiti, and I just will share this last thing. We're walking down the street, and a Haitian woman was like, "Pam, Pam." And she came up to us, and she's like, "I've been praying for you." And, you know, it just happened time and time again. She had all these people in the States praying, and then all these Haitians praying, and the Lord has healed her. So we're so grateful. Thank you so much.
Thank you. You can stay right here. Okay. Lord, thank you and praise you so much for the work that you're doing in Haiti. Lord, thank you. Thank you for Allison, for Doug, for Pam, for the ministry over all these years. Lord, meeting real needs, physical needs, hurting people, desperately hurting. But more than that, Lord, just how you work in meeting spiritual needs. Just showing yourself over and over again. Just listening to Allison is like the book of Acts. Just how you navigated and moved and your spirit led on that journey, Lord, to be able to, for them to be able to minister and to see you work and just give you all the praise and all the glory. Lord, meet their needs, whatever they may be. And if you could use us, Lord, through our finances, through our prayers, in any other way, to encourage and support this ministry, then please, have your way, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So thank you.
Father's arms are open wide for
So at this time, we are going to welcome a couple couples into the membership of our church. And so we don't put a lot of focus on membership here at FBC, but we have a class called, what do we call the class? FBC DNA, yeah. It's been so long since I've taught that class. Which gives you the introduction to the church, what we believe, our vision and dreams and how we work and how to get involved. And so if anybody would like to take that class, see Pastor Phil, he would really enjoy you being part of that. And the idea is, if you really feel like FBC is your home, it's a place where you really want to get involved, you want to serve, be part of, and then we encourage you to become a member. So today we have two couples. So we have John and Lisa DeMont, and we have Marty and Linda Wiles that are going to become members. So come on up, please. I'm going to make you come up on the stage because you love to do this. Come across the front here. Great. So it should come up on the screen. But if it doesn't,
looks like you prepared it.
I got it. It's up there. So they're going to do the first part of the covenant. When they finish, then we'll stand and we'll do our part. So you ready? All right. Confessing my love for God
and my faith in Jesus Christ, I now enter into the membership of this church. In so doing, I declare my purpose to live a Christian life and to share in the work and worship of this church by actively pursuing intimacy with God, community with other believers, and to be an influence for God's glory upon those outside the church. I covenant with God and my Christian brothers and sisters to be loyal to the church as it seeks to honor Christ, to attend so far as possible its appointed services, to regularly support the Lord's work in this church with tithes and offerings, to guard its good name, to walk with its members in love and faithfulness, and to promote its usefulness as God's instrument for the good of all. Trusting in the grace and help of God, I so covenant.
Thank you. It's a lot in there, isn't there? What they're committing to. So, and if I'd ask, please, at this time, if you would stand. And then this is our covenant. As the congregation, as the body of Christ, this is what we're committing to for them and ultimately, again, for the Lord. We, the members of this church, welcome you with joy into our fellowship. Renew our covenant of faith and loyal service, pledging to you our prayers, our help, and our life in Christ. To the end that we will all increase in the knowledge and love of God. May He grant us that loving and being loved, serving and being served, we may walk steadfastly as Christ's disciples, glorifying Him through faithful lives. Lord, thank you so much. For each of these people, they're in as individuals, as couples, their love for you, their commitment to you, their obedience to you. And Lord, thank you that they're part of this fellowship, this local church, this body. And Lord, I just pray that this, the joy of working and serving together, continue, Lord, I pray, to lead us all. To use our gifts, to use our talents, whatever you've given us, Lord, for the furtherance of the gospel, the building up of your glorious church, and most of all, Lord, for your honor, for your praise, for your glory. I ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. 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 So thank you very much, and please make sure. Please make sure that you welcome them after the service today. Thank you.
Seriously, Marty, you ready? All right, in season and out of season, he is always prepared. That's good. Well, thank you. That is a wonderful way to be welcomed up here for me. There's joy. There is joy. And I just want to thank the worship team this morning for leading us in worship. Praise is our right response all the time. All the time. In the highs and the lows, praise is the right response. God is worthy of our praise at all times. I'm reminded of the book of Job, chapter 1. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. And Job's response, blessed be the name of the Lord. Wow. It is our right response, and I thank you for leading us in worship this morning. And oh, it's so good to welcome these two couples. There are others who couldn't be here today that are planning to become members. They probably in the next few weeks will welcome them as well. I want you to know that I'm just thankful to be a part of this family. It's a good family. And I think we are not perfect. We rub each other wrong sometimes. We rub off the hard edges, but when push comes to shove, this is a family that loves one another. And is there for one another. So I'm privileged and blessed to be a part of it. So would you join me in prayer before we jump into God's word together? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. I thank you for the cause to praise that is found in your Son, Jesus. That no matter what is going on in our lives, we have hope. And we have joy. We have a confident expectation as your followers, as those who know you, that one day we are going to be with you for all eternity, praising you in ways that we cannot even imagine on this side. We thank you, God, for the incredible hope that those we love who know you are experiencing that even now. I thank you so much for my brother Al. I thank you, oh man, that he is praising you right now. I pray for your comfort for Tammy, her family. God, I thank you for the Wiles family. Just became members here this morning, but again, a family that we are walking through a time of grief. I pray that you would continue to bring comfort to Linda and their family at the loss of their grandchildren. Pray for the Davis family, that you would bring peace and comfort to Dick and Gail, Russ, and all the family. I do pray for Aaron, Kale as well. God, we've been reminded so much lately of the fragility of life. But God, we thank you that death does not get the final answer, but that because of your Son, Jesus, because of his victory over death and his resurrection from the grave, we know that there is life eternal. We thank you for that. And I just want to lift up a few others, God. I know they've been prayed for already, but God, I do pray for the Beaudets. Oh, would you be with that family right now? I want to thank you for the miracle of protecting John's life in that tragic accident. And he's still here. Others in the last few weeks we've said goodbye to, but John is still here. And so, God, I pray that he and all of us would be reminded that today is a gift and it's a day that's to be lived for your glory. And so use us, we pray, Lord. And God, as we turn our attention to your word, I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit that you would speak to our hearts. For those of us who know you, I pray, God, that we would be challenged to walk deeper with you, to trust you, to lead us every step of the way. And for those who don't already know you, they don't have a relationship with you. God, I pray that today is the day that they would turn to your Son, Jesus, as their Lord and Savior. Speak to us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So I read a story this week about a time when Pastor Alistair Begg was, he was out of town, he was speaking at a conference, and he woke up early in the morning, and he decided to head to a local restaurant to kind of put the finishing touches on the message he was going to be speaking that afternoon. And while he was there, he noticed a young lady who was intently reading a Bible. She was studying the scriptures. And so Alistair asked her, he said, I see that you are reading the Bible. Are you a Christian? And she smiled and she replied, oh, yes, I have found the narrow way. Oh, yes, I have found the narrow way. Her response surprised Alistair. He had never heard anybody answer like that. Have you? I haven't. She was a student at Harvard, and she was the only Christian in her family. She came from Korea. And both there and here, she lived in a culture which celebrates being open-minded and everybody choosing whatever faith or religion works for you. Certainly here in our culture, the idea of there being only one way is something that is rejected. But this young lady, she unashamedly embraced the narrow way. Jesus himself said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Sounds pretty narrow. And this young lady, she was so grateful to have found the narrow way. Well, if you have a Bible with you, we're going to return to our Luke series this morning. I invite you to turn with me to Luke chapter 13. Verses 22 to 35 is what we're going to be looking at this morning. And we're jumping back into this verse-by-verse study through Luke's gospel. And this morning, we're going to be looking at a passage where Jesus is going to be asked a question pertaining to salvation. You and I both know. We know that there are many, many thoughts and opinions about heaven, about hell, about who will be saved and who won't, and how you get there and how you don't. But at the end of the day, I hope you can agree with me that what really matters is not what Chris thinks about it. It isn't even what you think or anybody else thinks, or certainly what any of the most popular athletes out there think about these things. What really matters is what does God think? What does the Son of God, what is Jesus, the one who came from heaven to earth, what does he have to say about these things? And that's what we're going to look at this morning in our passage. So let's begin reading in Luke chapter 13, starting in verse 22. He, this is Jesus, went on his way through towns and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. So Luke begins this next section by reminding his reader that, once again, that Jesus is currently, he is on his way to Jerusalem. And this is a journey that we began back in chapter 9, verse 51, when we read that when the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. At the time when it was time for Jesus to wrap up his time on earth, he set his face to go to the cross. But it wasn't exactly a straight shot. This wasn't your typical pedal to the metal, how fast can we get to Jerusalem with no bathroom stops kind of a journey. That's the way that some of us like to travel. Go to the bathroom now and go again, because we're not stopping, guys. We're going. That is not what this journey was like for Jesus. This was more of a back and forth and all around sort of a scenic route kind of journey, Starting from up in Galilee in the north, Jesus is now making his way south, town by town, village by village, traveling in Samaria and Perea and in and out of Judea. And all along the way, Jesus knows that his time on earth is coming to a close. And so he's visiting with people, and he's performing miracles, and he's teaching about the kingdom of God. And Luke tells us that somewhere along this journey, in some village or some town, that as he's making his way through, in verse 23, someone said to him, "Lord, will those who are saved be few?" Now, we don't exactly know where this encounter took place, but most scholars agree that it was probably in the geographical region of Perea. This is a region that, along with Galilee, was ruled by Herod Antipas. And we've talked about Herod Antipas earlier in our series, and we'll talk about him a little bit more later in this text. But the question that he asks is, "Lord, will those who are saved be few?" Now, this could have been a very sincere question from one of his followers. I mean, Jesus had been, again, he's been traveling around, he's been performing miracles, he's been healing people, he's been preaching the good news of the kingdom, and yet many, actually most, especially from the religious crowd, had not embraced his message, and they had not received him as their Messiah. And so perhaps this person is kind of looking around, and he says, "Man, if the good news is such good news, why are so few choosing to follow? I mean, is it only going to be a few that are saved?" But it turns out that this was actually a very popular question at the time of Jesus. This is the type of question that rabbis would gather around amongst themselves and they would debate. Probably like people today might gather around and debate about Calvinism and Arminianism and like go at it head to head, right? They're both wrong, right? Can we just agree with everyone, right? So this is a debate. They would gather around, they would sit around, and they would have this debate about how many will be saved. Is it many or is it only a few? And of course, when the rabbis would have this debate, in their minds, they were thinking about Jews. The question in their minds wasn't, are Gentiles going to be saved? Clearly not the Gentiles. But will there be many Jews who are saved? Will it be all the Jews who are saved? Or will it only be a few, maybe the most devout? And so the question is like, well, what do you say, Jesus? What's your take? How do you weigh in on this debate? We don't really know who it was that asked this question. We don't even really know the reason why he asked it, but we do know how Jesus responds. And he takes this general question that everybody liked to debate about, and he makes it really personal. Luke says, "And he said to them, strive to enter through the narrow door. For many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able." Strive to enter through the narrow door. As Warren Wiersbe puts it, Jesus turns the question around. He says, the question is not how many will be saved, but whether or not you will be saved. Get that settled first, and then we can discuss what you can do to help get others saved. See, rather than focus on how many, start with a focus on how you can be saved. Make sure that you are one of them, and then you'll know how to lead others to the way of salvation. There is a way to be saved. There is a way. And Jesus says that it is through the narrow door. And so the first thing that I want us to see in this passage is that the way to salvation, some people aren't going to like this. It's narrow. It is narrow. Now, that is not a popular thing to say in our culture. People will say, oh, you Christians are so narrow-minded. I'm sorry. But when it comes to salvation, we have no choice. We have to be. Oh, I can be open-minded, but I can be open-minded and wrong. And the stakes are way too high to be wrong. Jesus is the only way. The salvation is narrow. And these are not my words, right? These are the words of the Son of God that came from heaven to earth. We don't have to like what Jesus says, but we do need to embrace it, and we need to obey it. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus, he said something similar. He said, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide, and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter it or by it are many. For the gate is narrow, and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few." And so once again, here in Luke chapter 13, Jesus says, so strive to enter through the narrow door. And the word that is translated here as strive is a Greek word from which we get our English word to agonize. To agonize. It's a word that was commonly used to describe the efforts of Olympic athletes in competition, straining and agonizing towards the goal, right? If they were battling with another competitor, it was to strain and agonize to do everything they could to obtain victory over their opponent. And Jesus says, you should strive to enter through the narrow door. You might be thinking, I've been in church for a while, Chris. And what you're saying, it does sound a whole lot like working to earn your salvation. I've sat through enough sermons to know that we are not saved by works, right? So what is up with this? Is Jesus contradicting everything else that is taught? And the clear answer is no. He's not contradicting. We could never do enough good to earn our salvation, could we? Never. Paul said in Ephesians chapter 2, by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast, right? The scriptures are abundantly clear that we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Jesus Christ alone. That's clear. He is the narrow door, and he is the only means for salvation. And so Jesus says, strive. He's saying, make sure. Do everything within your power to make every effort to be certain that you have put your faith in the only means for salvation. Strive to enter through the narrow door. Let's talk about this image that Jesus is painting of a narrow door. In that culture, in order to protect their property from thieves and intruders, many homes, at least those who had moderately well off, they would have a walled-in courtyard around their home. And within this surrounding wall, there would be a large, solid door that would be opened, you know, as needed to let in animals or to allow in carts to come into the courtyard. But within this larger solid door, there was a smaller door, a narrow door, that was used by family and guests as they would come and go to the home. They wouldn't enter through the big wide door. They would walk through the small man door. Chuck Swindoll calls this smaller narrow door the approved entrance to the home. If you knew the homeowner, you could just walk right through that door, right? Who would sneak over the wall? Who would sneak, right? Intruders, right? This was the approved entrance. It was the right way to enter. And so when it comes to salvation, when it comes to eternal life in heaven, there is only one approved entrance. There's only one approved way to enter. Jesus is the only means for salvation. Jesus said, I am the way, right? I am the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me, John 14:6. So Jesus says, strive to enter through the narrow door. In John 3, Jesus said, for God so loved the world that he did what? He gave his only son that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. Friends, Jesus is the narrow door to salvation, but the door is wide open. It's wide open. There's only one way to get there, but that door is open for all, for whosoever believes in him, whoever will come to him by faith. So strive to enter through the narrow door. For many, Jesus says, will seek to enter, and they will not be able. And in verse 25, he continues, and he says, they will seek to enter and not be able when once the master of the house has risen and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and to knock at the door, saying, Lord, open to us. He will answer you, I do not know where you come from. Then you will begin to say, we ate and drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets. But he will say, I tell you, I do not know where you come from. Depart from me, all you workers of evil. So the second thing I want us to see in this passage is that while the door of salvation is open to all who will enter through faith in Jesus, the door will eventually be closed. And what Jesus says here is that when the door is closed, it will be too late. Again, in that culture, it was common to leave that smaller, narrow door open during the daytime hours. People could come and go. But at night, the door would be closed and it would be locked. In fact, even the gates to a city, most of the cities in those days had a big wall around them. Some of them had double gates, triple gates. But the gates of the city would be closed up and they would be locked at night. And so if you were a traveler and you arrived to the city after the gates were closed and locked, you can knock all you want. You're not coming in. You're going to have to seek lodging outside the city walls for the night. And so like a door to a home or like a gate to a city, there comes a time when the door is shut. And friends, the hard truth that we all need to realize is that for each and every one of us, there comes a day when the door of opportunity is going to come to a close. That's a reality. We don't like to think about that, do we? So whether that day comes by the return of Jesus or whether that day comes by our own death, when that time comes and the door is shut, if we have not entered through the narrow door, it will be too late. Strive to enter through the narrow door. A couple of weeks ago, I received a message. It was a good one. This is a good one. I got a message from Adelia Thurston. You're gonna think I'm weird when I say this next part, but okay, it is a good one. This part's not good. She She was letting me know that Wayne's father had passed away. Okay, so that part's not that's not the good part. Wayne's dad, get this, was nearly 102 years old. That's incredible. I mean, we just talked about this the other day. Like, imagine all that he's seen over 102 years. But here's the good news. By the absolutely amazing grace of God, Wayne's dad found the narrow door just 2 months before he passed. 101 years old. Can you say praise God for his amazing grace? He kept that man alive 101 years till he bent his knee to the Lord. That's amazing. Never, ever, ever stop praying for your loved ones. Never stop praying for your loved ones to come to Christ. As long as they have breath in their lungs, as long as that door is open, there is still hope. There is still hope. I love that message from Adelia. Of course, by sharing that story, some of you might be tempted to think, well, sounds like I have all the time in the world. I'm not even close to 101. I'm not even close. Yeah, I heard that. I don't want to live that long. But, I mean, come on. This church knows all too well. Knows all too well over the last few weeks that we don't know how much time any of us has left, do we? We don't know when the door is going to close. We don't know when our time is up. Last week, we were all shocked, stunned, to wake up on Saturday morning to the news that our dear brother and an elder in this church, Al Farishinian, left this world and entered the presence of his Savior, Jesus Christ. Many of us, many, I mean like 50 plus of us, spent time with Al on Friday, right? We worked with him. We ate lunch with him. We sang with him. We prayed with him. After shoulder to shoulder, Al went home and he mowed his lawn. He had dinner with his wife. He went to bed and he fell asleep and he woke up in the presence of Jesus. Amazing. Amazing, but totally unexpected. Face to face with the one he loved and served so faithfully. Oh, for Al, what a glorious moment, right? Praise God. We rejoice for him. Al had found the narrow door. And by the way, if you knew Al, he talked about the narrow door. The way, the truth, and the life was on his lips always. He wanted everyone to know it. Friends, we don't know when our time is up. We don't. But when the door is closed, when the door is closed, it is too late to enter. Notice what Jesus says here. He says that those who are shut out, they're going to say this. They're going to say, well, we ate and we drank in your presence and you taught in our streets. And Jesus will say, I don't know you. I don't know. I don't know where you come from. Again, in another passage in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said this. He said, on that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. I'd love to spend all of our time just on that one passage. But what we see in these verses is that, listen, proximity to Jesus is not the same as relationship with Jesus. Proximity to Jesus is not the same as relationship with Jesus. And I'm really afraid that many people spend their whole lives coming to services like this thinking, I'm with Jesus, but all you've been is in proximity to him and still don't have a relationship with him. And that's a scary place to be. Do you know Jesus? And more importantly, does Jesus know you? Because we can say the right words, and they are right words. Lord, Lord, those are good words, because he is Lord. But you can say Lord, Lord, and not mean Lord, Lord, right? You know that Lord means master. You could say I'm your master, but if you don't do what I tell you, then guess I'm not really your master, right? We can pile up all kinds of good deeds. You can do lots of good things, but if we do not have a relationship with Jesus, salvation is impossible. Again, these aren't my words. These are the words of Jesus. And so he says, strive to enter through the narrow door. Surrender your life to Jesus as your Lord, as your master. By faith, receive the forgiveness of your sins that was made possible by his death and his resurrection from the grave. So when it comes to salvation, it's all about a relationship with Jesus. Attending church, singing songs, reading a Bible, serving the poor, loving your neighbor. Man, you can, those are good things. Is there anything wrong with those things? Of course not. You should do those things. But the thing is, you can do all of those things and not have a relationship with Jesus. You can. So strive to enter through the narrow door. Make sure that you know him and he knows you. And let me just throw this out there. When you look around at the people around you, don't be so quick to think in your mind, oh, that's a Christian, that's not, that's a Christian, that's not. Because you're evaluating what? What you see. What will determine whether or not they are saved is what's happening inside here. That's the reality. By God's grace, make sure that you know him and he knows you. And don't wait, don't put it off, because you do not know when the door will close. But when it's closed, it'll be too late. Jesus will say, depart from me, all you workers of evil. And in verse 28, he continues and he says, and in that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves cast out. And people will come from east and west and from north and south and recline at table in the kingdom of God. And behold, some are last who will be first. And some are first who will be. You're going to be surprised who's in heaven. The third thing I want us to see in Jesus' words here is that the decision that we make carries eternal consequences. For those who have entered through the narrow door, these words are great. They're wonderful. For those who have come to faith through Jesus, there is a great feast that awaits them. A celebration with people from every tribe and nation, every people and language, gathering with, look at these people, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. You don't want to hang out with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? It sounds pretty awesome to me. You know, ask them some questions. Yes, that's a good hand. All the prophets together for all eternity in the joyful presence of the Lord. All those loved ones who knew Jesus before you, together with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Peter, James, John, all of them gathered together. But for those who refuse to enter through the narrow door, those who refuse to turn from their sins and follow Jesus, they will be separated from God for all eternity in a place where Jesus says there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And friends, nobody likes to talk about it. I don't like to talk about it. It's not my favorite topic. Hey, come over, we'll have a barbecue, we'll talk about hell. It's not my favorite topic, but it's real. Hell is real. In fact, did you know that nobody in the scriptures talked more about hell than Jesus? Nobody. The very one who left heaven and came to earth in order to save us from hell. Why does he talk so much about hell? Because he doesn't want anyone to go there. He doesn't. If you've got this picture of God saying, oh, I can't wait to send him to hell, it's not real. That's not real. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He wants everyone to come to faith in Christ and spend eternity with him in heaven. It is worth noting here that this Jewish audience, when they heard the words, how many will be saved? What would have been shocking to them wasn't his answer about, you know, many or few. What would have been shocking to them is the fact that, because in the Jewish mindset, it was all about how many Jews will be saved. But Jesus here describes people coming from east and west and from north and south to recline at the table and feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of God. Who's he describing there? He's describing Gentiles, which is pretty good news for you and me, right? But this would have been absolutely shocking to his Jewish audience that he's talking to. How many Jews are going to be saved? Oh, let me tell you, more than Jews, they're Gentiles from all over are going to be sitting around the table with you. Isn't that great? Well, I think it's great. But to that audience, that is, for some of them, that was a repulsive thought. Absolutely repulsive. This would have been shocking news for them to hear. Jesus says that some are last who will be first, and some are first who will be last. In Galatians chapter 3, Paul says that in the kingdom of God, there's no Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male nor female. You are all one in Christ Jesus. That's great news. It's really great news, but it would have been hard news for this Jewish crowd to hear at the time. It was hard for even the disciples. It took a while of convincing, even as the gospel began to break forth from Jerusalem to Judea and Samaria. As the gospel is spreading, they're like, whoa, what's going on? And Peter sees a sheet coming down and says, you can eat this food. And Peter's like, I don't think so. And he's like, yeah, you're going to. And the gospel was breaking forth. It was shocking to these early Jewish Christians. But praise God. What incredible news. And Luke continues, and in verse 31, we read that at that very hour, some Pharisees came and they said to him, get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you. As Jesus is teaching, and he's answering this question about how many will be saved, breaking the news that there's going to be Gentiles in the mix, at that very hour, some Pharisees come and they warn Jesus that Herod wants to kill him. Now, this is the same Herod Antipas, who had John the Baptist beheaded. We talked about that earlier in our series. The forerunner from Jesus has already been taken out by Herod Antipas. And so they come to Jesus and they say, you better get out of here or your head is next. You better start running. I wonder, for those of you who'd never read it, do you think Jesus is going to run? No. Now, by this point in our study in Luke's gospel, okay, we've read enough stories to know that by and large, the Pharisees were not fans of Jesus. They're not fans of Jesus. They're not followers of Jesus, at least not many. There were a few exceptions we read about, like Nicodemus or Joseph of Arimathea. But by and large, most of the Pharisees hated Jesus, and they were determined to do away with him. So, it is possible that this warning from these Pharisees came from a genuine concern for Jesus. Maybe they were one of the very few Pharisees who were genuinely concerned, like, look out, Jesus, we're really worried for your welfare. That is possible. But more than likely, I would venture a guess that these Pharisees are more concerned with scaring Jesus to drive him away from their region. We don't want you talking anymore about this idea of Gentiles being in the kingdom. Get out of here, right? And where are they trying to drive him towards? Jerusalem. Because remember that Herod Antipas is the ruler of Perea, where, you know, to the east of the Jordan, and up in Galilee. So they're not trying to drive him back up to Galilee, not trying to keep him over in Perea. They want to drive him towards Jerusalem, where there's already a plot underfoot to do away with Jesus. Let's drive him away. But whatever their motivation was, Jesus was not scared. And Jesus was not running. In verse 32, we read, he said to them, Go and tell that fox. I love that. Don't you like that? Behold, I cast out demons and perform cures today and tomorrow and the third day I finished my course. Nevertheless, I must go on my way today and tomorrow and the day following, for it cannot be that a prophet should perish away from Jerusalem. Oh, I know where I'm headed. I'm headed to Jerusalem. But don't you just love his reply here? Go tell that fox. Translation, go tell that sneaky pest. You tell that destructive fox that I will leave when it's time for me to leave. I have a mission. I've got things to do. I have work to do that my Father has given me. I have demons to cast out. I have people to heal. And I will not leave until the work that my Father has been given to me is going to be accomplished. I'm not leaving. But tell him not to worry. I'll be on my way soon. Soon enough. Besides, I can't die here. I can't die here. Not here in Perea. No, like many of the prophets before me, I am going to die in Jerusalem. And then, at the mention of Jerusalem on his lips, we see the emotion of Jesus come forth. His heart is stirred, and he says in verse 34, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. Behold, your house is forsaken. And I tell you, you will not see me until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Jesus says, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem." You should do a study this week if you have time. In the scriptures, whenever you see the repetition of a name like that, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, it's a way of emphasizing the intimacy and the depth of a relationship. Jesus did it other times. You maybe remember from Luke 7 when Jesus was talking to Martha, right, at Mary and Martha's home. He said, "Oh, Martha, Martha." He said it to Simon Peter, on the night that he was betrayed in the upper room. "Simon, Simon, Satan wants to sift you. Simon, Simon." The road to Damascus, he said it to Saul when he knocked him off his horse, right? "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Whenever you see that repetition, it's a way of emphasizing intimacy and the depth of a relationship. And so Jesus says, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem." His love for the Jewish people is pouring from his lips. "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it." As you read the Old Testament scriptures, you see how time after time God has sent prophets to confront his people. He sent them to warn them to repent of their sins and to turn back to God. And time after time, they rejected the prophets. They persecuted, even killed many of God's messengers. Jesus says, "How often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings?" Can you see that picture? That the love of a mother hen gathering to protect her babies. "If you only knew how much I love you, Jerusalem. I came for you. I am here for you. But you were not willing." You weren't willing. The Messiah was there. He was in their midst, but they were unwilling to receive him. And because of their unwillingness to receive Jesus, because they will reject him, they will have him crucified, Jesus prophesies about the coming judgment of his people. He says, "Your house is forsaken." And we know that in 70 AD, the Romans would completely destroy the city of Jerusalem. They would destroy the temple. But that is not the end of the story for Israel. That's not the end of the story. As John MacArthur points out, there is a future for Israel in the plan of God. The time will come when Israel will say to Christ, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And in that future day, when they confess Jesus as their Messiah, Israel will recognize who he truly is. As it says in Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, God will pour out on them a spirit of grace and pleas for mercy. And they will, I love this verse, they will look on me, God says. They will look on me. Just think about this for a second. They will look on me, God says, whom they have pierced. Whom they have pierced. That's a really powerful verse, by the way, if you're looking for a verse about the deity of Christ. And they will mourn for him. They will mourn for him. And MacArthur says, then the fountain of cleansing will come to them from heaven. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. You were not willing. What about you? Are you willing? Are you willing? I heard one pastor say that, he said, all roads do lead to God. All roads lead to God. He said, well, that contradicts what you just said. But then he clarified, every single human being is going to stand before God one day. It doesn't matter which road you decide that you're going to take. You can take the wide road, you can take the narrow road, but every human being is going to stand before God one day. But only those who took the narrow way will enter into eternal life. All roads lead to God, but not all roads lead to heaven. Are you going to take the wide way that many travel, or are you going to take the narrow way? Strive to enter the narrow way. God loves you so much that he sent his son to die in your place. Have you received him? Like the young lady in that restaurant, have you found the narrow way? Have you surrendered your life to Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Jesus is the narrow door. He is the only means for salvation. If you have never surrendered your life to Jesus, I pray that today's the day. You don't know. We don't know how much time we have left. But we do know there's only one way to secure your eternal destiny, and that is through Jesus Christ. And so I pray that if you have never given your life to Jesus, that today is the day you would turn over your life to him. Receive him as your Lord and Savior. If you have questions about that, please, please come and talk to me after the service. I would love to talk with you, to pray with you. If you don't want to talk to me, I get it. Talk to somebody else here. There's all kinds of people who would love to talk to you about that decision. In John chapter 1, John is one of the closest disciples to Jesus. It's so close. He loved Jesus. Jesus loved John. John tells us that he came to his own, the Jewish people. And his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, and I pray that that describes you, he gave the right to become children of God. They found the narrow way. Strive to enter through the narrow door. The narrow door has a name, and his name is Jesus. Strive to enter through Jesus. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for sending your son, Jesus, our Messiah, our Savior, our Lord. And we thank you that because of his death, because of his resurrection, and because he has made this way possible, we can be restored into a right relationship with you. He is the narrow door. He is the way to be reconciled with you for not just today, but for all eternity. God, I pray if there's anybody here who has never given their life to you through Jesus, I pray that today would be the day they turn over their life to you. I pray that you would fight through any obstacles, in their minds about why they should or shouldn't do this, and that they would surrender. We know that you are not a God who delights in the death of the wicked. You want them to repent, to receive eternal life. And I pray, God, I pray that whoever hears this message, if they do not know you, that they would repent and turn to you. And I pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Thank you. God, we praise you. We thank you that you've already won the battle. God, we just have to enter through you. Lord Jesus, we love you so much, and we thank you for what you've already done for us. I pray that each one of us would make you Lord of our lives. Lord, that we would submit ourselves to you and allow you to work in and through us. We thank you and praise you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Have a wonderful week, everybody.